Good morning. Welcome to Christ Lutheran. A special welcome to those of you who are visitors with us today and those of you who have joined us online. And we're glad that you can be with us. For those of you, especially those of you who have joined us online, we want to note that this week the audiovisual team was in doing some reconfiguring of our audiovisual system. And we'll be tweaking it throughout the service a little bit. So if there's some changes or some problems, especially online, don't worry, we're hopefully going to get that all sorted out by the end of the service. And I have some announcements that I'd like to draw your attention to, starting with the devotion books that many of you use. Eternity for Today, which was printed by a different company. This current episode or issue is being printed by the ELCIC head office, and it's not available quite yet, but it will be coming. And also, Christ in Our Home, we don't know exactly why that hasn't shown up yet. So if you're wondering where these devotion books are, we're just as clued out as you. And we're hoping that they'll show up shortly. So just in case you were wondering about those, our daily bread will be here, and you can pick those up when they arrive. And then I wanted to note that this week, this Friday, is our next youth group. The CLIP group is going to be meeting on Friday at 7 for a campfire and glow-in-the-dark games, which sounds like fun. If you have any questions, you can ask our parish worker, Carrie, who is just right over here, and she can answer any questions you have about that. And then I wanted to note that the men's breakfast has now changed, made some changes. They're starting at 9 a.m., and they're meeting at Regent Park Restaurant. And if you have any questions, you can contact Bruno Nuremberg, and his phone number is in the bulletin there, the announcement sheet. And then the last thing that I want to announce is that starting tomorrow, I'm beginning a study leave, almost 3 weeks in length. And the whole point of this is to try and do concentrated work on my thesis, which I have not been able to do very successfully over the course of the summer and this fall. Pastor Lynn will be around during that whole time, so if you can just get a hold of Pastor Lynn. And so then I would ask you to do two things. One, to refrain from contacting me by email or messenger or text or all that kind of stuff, because I'm going to try and really focus on my studies. And secondly, if you could pray that I would actually be focused and dedicated in my studies, right? So I don't get distracted by, a grandchild or something like that, could happen. So that's my announcements that I want to make. And I'll just point out that Beth Kellen is our worship assistant today, and we give thanks for her participation in leading worship. Yesterday, September 30th, was the National Day of Truth and Reconciliation. And the day before, the ceremonial gardens at Indigenous Christian Fellowship was dedicated, and I was at that along with Pastor Lynn and some other folks from Christ Lutheran, and that was a marvelous event, and that's going to be a marvelous space that people will be able to use in the future. But what I would like to do today is just say a few things initially. And then during the service, there will be you'll notice there'll be a few occasions where reconciliation is mentioned, and this is our way of acknowledging. So I'd like to begin with a land acknowledgement, and I begin by acknowledging that the land on which we gather is Treaty 4 and Treaty 6 territory and the traditional territory of the Cree, Soto, Assiniboia, and Métis peoples. An introduction to Truth and Reconciliation. On June 2nd, 2015, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission issued 94 calls to action. The calls are to government, churches, and all Canadians to reset the relationship between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people. There are 42 of the calls of action, or calls to action, are titled Legacy, and they deal with the impacts of residential schools. And 52 calls to action are titled reconciliation, and they provide foundation stones for building a new, just relationship. In worship, we honor God's call to seek, to encounter, and to know God. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation, and we pray that God opens our hearts to the calls for reconciliation. One of those 94 calls to action, call number 59, says this: we call upon churches to develop ongoing education strategies to ensure that their respective congregations learn about their church's role in colonization and in residential schools, and why apologies are necessary. And in reflection of that call, there is a prayer I'd like to offer. Let us pray. God of reason and understanding, we love to talk about theology, but sometimes our talk leads to actions of violence, not love. Sometimes our practices divide rather than reconcile. Lead us to face the truth of the past and to work for peace in the future. Remind us that confession from the heart leads to healing of the heart, that words of truth build trust. Stir us to respond to your longing for a new creation to heal and restore the circle of your people. Help us work for reconciliation. Amen. And now I'd like us to take just a few minutes of quiet reflection as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. I'll invite you to stand as we join in a call to worship. We gather because we are God's people.
Day by day, Sunday by Sunday, we praise the living God.
We are a community in Christ Jesus. In praise, in prayer, in teaching and fellowship, we are sustained by our Lord.
Let us worship God.
As you remain standing, we'll sing our gathering hymn, "Come Now, O Prince of Peace." Turn now to a prayer of adoration and confession. God of all peoples, in all times and places, hear this assurance. In Christ, we are forgiven and reconciled to God. You may be seated as we sing our next hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. This time I'd like to call the baptismal family forward. So this is Lincoln. And I just think this is a neat little trivia thing, so I'm going to just mention it, is that Lincoln's grandparents were the first couple that I married when I came to Christ Lutheran. So it's neat to just see all the generations. It is Lincoln. Yeah, it is. Let us celebrate God's gift of grace given to us in the sacrament of baptism. In baptism, God promises to love us, forgive us, and always be with us. By water and the Spirit, we are called, claimed, and commissioned. We are called God's own, welcomed as children of God, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. In the Gospel of Mark, yes, that's what he said, yes. In the Gospel of Mark, we read Jesus' words, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. So I'll ask parents and sponsors, who is it that you present for baptism? You have brought Lincoln to receive the sacrament of holy baptism, and on the strength of God's gracious love for us, and in communion with the Christian church, will you, by your words and actions, encourage and walk with Lincoln in the way of Jesus? Do you promise to pray for him and to teach him to pray? Do you promise to nurture him within the community of the Christian church? And people of God, do you promise to support Lincoln and pray for him in his new life in Christ? Parents and sponsors, I ask you to reject sin, acknowledge your faith in Christ Jesus, and profess the faith of the Christian church. Trusting in God's love and mercy, do you reject evil and all its many forms and all its empty promises? And trusting in Christ Jesus' grace and love, do you accept his presence in your life as the one who draws you to God? With all God's people, throughout time and space, let us together profess our faith in the triune God. Do you believe in God? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for the gift of life and within it, the gift of water. Now may your Spirit be upon us and what we do, that this water may be a sign for all of new life in Christ. To you be given praise and honor and worship through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. For you, little Lincoln, God made the world out of nothing. For you, God called Israel out of Egypt and brought Israel back from exile. For you, little child, Christ came into the world to teach the children. For you, Christ died on the cross and rose again. For you, God sent the Holy Spirit to give you strength to live as you ought. For you, Christ will come again and take us to God. Little Lincoln, you know nothing of this, but we promise to tell you the story until you make it your own. And so we baptize. I baptize you, Lincoln Michael Komiak, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May God, who is giving you new life through water, word, and spirit, guide you, inspire you, and work within you all the days of your life. Amen. And one more thing. You're going to mark a little cross on your forehead like this. There we go. Lincoln, child of God, on this day you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the sign of the cross. Joined with Jesus, you are a child of God now and forever.
Let the light of Christ, which God has placed in your heart, shine through your words and actions from this day forward. Eternal Spirit, send your grace and peace to Lincoln and to his family. As you have ignited the spark of life within him, so let us help to kindle that spark into a dancing flame, that Lincoln may grow in the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ. Guide and protect him throughout his life. Through this little one, may we learn of your gentleness and love. Amen.
I'll invite the congregation to stand as we welcome Lincoln into our family. Family of God, we now receive Lincoln Komniak into Christ's church. With joy and thanksgiving, we to the family of faith, we promise to love, encourage, and support you, and to help you know and follow Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you. I'll invite you to share the peace with those around you in a way that you're comfortable, and as we do that up here. To sing a song now that's one of my favorite sort of baptismal songs by Marty Haugen. It's called Song Over the Waters.
Of wind and flame, and
known as affirmation of baptism. And we have just started our confirmation classes for the fall, and we would like at this time for the confirmation students to come forward and stand up here, and our parish worker Carrie Frosted is going to introduce them, and plus their pictures will be on the screen. I know we don't have every single one of them here, but we have quite a few, and we're happy that they have joined us. So come on up here. Come on up here and face the congregation. There we go. There we go. And when Carrie says your name, just give a little wave, okay? So people out there can put names and faces together. Okay, Carrie.
Second year, and we have Luke Hack, first year. Mary Hilderman, second year. Owen Hilderman, first year. Xavier Hodsman is second year. Liam Honeysett, I don't think is here. He is first year. Gabriel Lewis is second year. He's not here either. Liam Peebles, first year. Jayton Schaefer is first year. He's not here today. Mason Visco, I don't think I see. No Mason today, he's first year. Alexis Weslowski is second year. And Skylar Wittig is second year.
And for our first year students, we're going to give them something that already the second year students got last year, and that is a Bible that they will use throughout their studies. This is a copy of the Common English Bible, which is the translation we use most often in our worship services. So, for the first year students, here's your Bible. And then I'm going to say a prayer for the students here. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask that you would help be with each of these confirmation students in the weeks and months ahead. Help them to strengthen their faith, increase their understanding, deepen their relationships with you and with one another. Give them guidance in their daily lives, courage in difficult circumstances, and comfort in times when they feel discouraged. Bless them in their studies and through their activities. We pray this for our young people in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you want to welcome them with a round of applause? Thank you. That was relatively painless, wasn't it? Now you can go back to your seats. The Lord be with you. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. Creator God, from you every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. You have rooted and grounded us in your covenant love and empowered us by your Spirit to speak the truth in love and to walk in your way towards justice and wholeness. Mercifully grant that your people, journeying together in partnership, may be strengthened and guided to help one another to grow into the full stature of Christ, who is our light and our life. Amen. We hear from Scripture.
A reading from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. This reading is from the First Nations Version, an Indigenous translation of the New Testament. As you walk the road with the Chosen One, have you gained from him courage for the journey? Have you found comfort in his love? Do you share together in his Spirit? Has his tenderness and mercy captured your heart? If so, then have the same kind of thoughts. Love with one heart, join together in one spirit, and walk side by side on one path. This will make my heart leap for joy. But when you do these things, make sure you do them for the right reasons. Do not let selfish ways take you down a path of bragging or try to look better than others. Instead, let humility be your guide as you honor others above yourself. Each of you should look to the needs of others, not just to your own. Think about yourselves in the same way Creator sets free, Jesus, the chosen one, thought about himself. Even though Creator sets free, Jesus has always been the same as the Great Spirit and shared everything equally with him, he did not even think of holding on to this in a selfish way. Instead, he emptied himself, became nothing, and gave up all he had. Then, having been born as a human being, he took on himself the lowly form of a servant. As a true human being, he lowered himself even more by following the guidance of the Great Spirit, even when death was waiting for him at the end of the trail, death on a tree pole, the cross. Because Creator sets free, Jesus did this. The Great Spirit gave him an honored place above all others and bestowed on him a name greater than all other names, so that all who live in the spirit world above, on the earth below, and underneath the earth will bow their knee to Creator sets free, Jesus, in honor of his name. Then everyone in their native language will shout out loud that Creator sets free, Jesus, the chosen one, is grand chief over all the earth. This will bring honor and praise to our Father, the Great Spirit. My much-loved family, you have always followed my guidance, not only when I was with you, but much more now that I am away. So then, with great respect, you must walk the path Creator has given you for being set free and made whole. For the Great Spirit is creating in you the desire and strength to do what pleases him. Here ends the reading.
I'll invite you to stand in preparation for the gospel. We'll sing the gospel acclamation, Voice of Creation. Gospel according to Matthew, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him as he was teaching. They asked, "What kind of authority do you have for doing these things? Who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I have a question for you. If you tell me the answer, I'll tell you what kind of authority I have to do these things. Where did John get his authority to baptize? Did he get it from heaven or from humans?" They argued amongst themselves, "If we say from heaven, he'll say to us, 'Then why didn't you believe him?' But we can't say from humans because we're afraid of the crowd, since everyone thinks John was a prophet." Then they replied, "We don't know." Jesus also said to them, "Neither will I tell you what kind of authority I have to do these things." "What do you think?" A man had two sons. Now he came to the first and said, "Son, go work in the vineyard today." "No, I don't want to," he replied. But later, he changed his mind and went. The father said the same thing to the other son, who replied, "Yes, sir," but he didn't go. Which of these two did his father's will? They said, "The first one." Jesus said to them, "I assure you that tax collectors and prostitutes are entering God's kingdom ahead of you. For John came to you on the righteous road and you didn't believe him. But tax collectors and prostitutes believed him. Yet even after you saw this, you didn't change your hearts and lives and you didn't believe him." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please pray with me. Gracious God, we ask that you would open our ears and our minds to the fullness of your message for us this day. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let me tell you about an incident that happened in my life when I was a teenager. I think it was grade 12. And you know, when you're in grade 12, you think that, hey, I'm on the cusp of entering the adult world. I'm a pretty mature person. I'm a pretty special person. You know, like the world is my oyster and all this kind of stuff. You think you've got it made. So I was thinking I was a pretty good guy, because I didn't give my parents much grief. I wasn't out partying and getting drunk on weekends like some of my other classmates. You know, I practiced my piano like I was supposed to. I did my homework sometimes, but I didn't certainly say I wasn't going to do my homework. I thought I was a pretty good son. One day in the fall, around this time of year, I was going over to visit one of my school friends. Her name was Ruth Mortimer, and she was the daughter of the Anglican minister in town. And Ruth and I enjoyed conversations, and we could get talking, and the conversation would go all kinds of places and lots of subjects. And this particular night, because where Ruth lived, it was very close to my grandparents' house. And my grandparents were away. I think they were visiting some of the family in another place, maybe Calgary. Anyways, they were away, and they were worried about the tomatoes. So they didn't want the tomatoes to freeze. So we can have there's some tomatoes that are getting frostbitten there on there. They didn't want that. So Dad said to me, "Well, since you're going over to Ruth's place, on your way back, would you stop by Grandpa and Grandma's house and cover their tomatoes?" And I, being a good son, said, "Yeah, sure, I can do that. I'll do that." And so off I went to Ruth's place, and I got into a long conversation with Ruth and actually her mom. So the three of us were sitting around the kitchen table having this long conversation, and before you knew it, it was like 11 o'clock at night, and it was like, I better get home. So I rushed home, and totally forgot about the tomatoes. But my dad didn't forget about the tomatoes. And there, sitting on the dishwasher, I can see it to this day, I can see this, a note that said, "We're disappointed, Dennis, because you promised to cut tomatoes, but we had to go over and do it because you hadn't done it and it was getting late and stuff like that." And I realized that, you know, I had said I was going to do something, and then I didn't do it. I couldn't even pretend that I had gone to Grandpa and Grandma's and said, "Oh, the tomatoes are already covered," because I didn't. I just went home. All right, so why did I tell you this story? Because I thought of this story when we look at this parable from Jesus. So Jesus is saying, you know, what do you think? He's saying to the religious leaders of his day, "What do you think about this? A man had two sons. And the first, he asks, would you go and work in the vineyard?" So So it was obviously harvest time, maybe, and there was a lot of work to be done. So he asked the first son, would you go and work in the vineyard? And that son says, no, I got some other things I got to do today, Dad. I don't know what, I mean, the fullness of the story. We don't know what his reasons are. He just says no. He's not going to do it. But then, Jesus says, later on, he changes his mind and goes and works in the vineyard. The second son, when asked, would you go and work in the vineyard, says, yes, sir, I'll do it. And then he didn't do it. Now, I think Jesus is telling this story because probably everybody could identify with it in some way or another, either because their own kids had behaved that way or they had behaved that way when they were kids or whatever, right? But they could all recognize, yeah, there are times when we say, oh, we're going to do something, and then we don't actually do it. And what Jesus is indicating to the leaders is that words are not good enough. You can't say, you know, that you are doing God's will if you're not actually doing it. And those people who at one time said either maybe they didn't believe in God or God wasn't important to them, but then they found that importance in their life and they turned to God, you know, Jesus is saying those people are actually going to get into the kingdom ahead of you. Why? Because they've already recognized the truth of what John the Baptist said. In other words, the truth about me as Jesus. Who am I? Right? I am the Son of God come down from heaven. I am the Lamb of God, which is what John the Baptist called him at one point, to take away the sins of the world. Here to take away the sins of the world. And so the prostitutes and tax collectors, who were both people that were considered, you know, groups of people that were considered, you know, outside the margins of society, the tax collectors because they worked with the Romans, and that was bad. And who likes tax collectors ever? Nobody likes tax collectors. But this was particularly bad because they worked with the Romans, right? So they were traitors as well as, you know, people. And one other thing to maybe mention about tax collectors in Jesus' day is that the way they made their money is the Romans said, okay, in this region, you're responsible for this region, you have to collect this much taxes. Anything more is yours. So if a tax collector was wealthy, the people said, we've been ripped off. He's been skimming more than he should, and that makes us hate him even more. Okay? All right. So that's tax collectors. You can see why an average Jewish person in Jesus' day would not really like tax collectors. And prostitutes were seen as people who, there was a problem with them because most of the prostitutes in Jesus' day, by the way, were women who had been divorced by their husbands and kicked out of the house. And because women couldn't own property or run a business, they had no means of income except for one particular thing that they could do. And so in desperation, they turned to prostitution just to survive. That's the majority of them. There was others related to temple worship of the Greek gods and so on and so forth. But that was primarily what we have. So we have women who are vulnerable, but they're being blamed for their problems, right? Well, they brought it on themselves. It's their own fault. So these, you know, they're not good people like us. There's the problem, right there. The people in Jesus' day saw themselves as better than others. And so they automatically discounted others or saw them as lesser than. I think this is one place where we can tie in truth and reconciliation, because in times past, I think there was a significant portion of our population who saw indigenous people as lesser than. And then because of that, you can treat them a certain way. And we've done this with all kinds of groups of people. We've seen them as lesser than for whatever reason. They're different than us in some way. But we're the good ones, right? But Jesus is pointing out, oh, you think you're the good ones because you say, when the Father asks you to go and work in the vineyard, yeah, we'll go, sure, yeah, we'll do that. But then you don't actually do what you've been asked to do. So Jesus is saying, you got to walk the walk, not just talk the talk. If you claim to be following God's ways, it should be evident in the way that you behave. You begin with humility. That's how you begin. By recognizing that you are not better than the others who are also on this path, that you are blessed simply to be called by God to follow this path of reconciliation with God and reconciliation with one another. And so you need to do things that show that you are indeed in relationship with God, and that that is spilling over into your relationships with one another. You need to do the work. Now, in the letter to the Philippians, which we read from today, it talks about Christ being humble. This is an important aspect of our understanding of who Jesus is. Jesus is, you know, the Son of God, God in human form, come to be among us, but he does so in a way that is completely humble. He doesn't come as some grand leader who's going to command the troops and force his will on everybody. He comes as a gentle, loving shepherd who cares for his flock. Something you need to know about shepherds, because I think we have a romanticized image of shepherds today. Shepherds in Jesus' day were kind of seen as kind of the lowest, you know, sort of place in society. Like they were considered kind of like, those guys, you know, like they're not worth very much. They're not very important. Which is why in the Christmas story, when the shepherds come and see the newborn Jesus, there's a message there for us, which is to say, Jesus comes to even the least of these. Jesus comes to even the humble ones, the ones that society puts on the margin, the ones that society forgets about. That's who Jesus comes to. And Jesus himself is humble. He doesn't force his way on people. He invites them to follow him and to learn from him and to change their hearts and minds and then discover the joy of being a child of God. So, me, when I went through these passages today, I was reminded of the importance of beginning our relationship with God and with one another with an attitude of humility like Christ had. An attitude of humility. About that, but I'll just say this. I wrote about it in the broadcaster. So just read my broadcaster article, and you've just saved yourself 7 minutes of the sermon. Humility is something that is lacking, I think, in our world. People have ideas about whatever, and they think that their ideas are the most important, and they're just going to bulldoze anybody who has different ideas. But I think what Jesus shows us is that we reach out to all those around us, because Jesus reached out to not just the prostitutes and tax collectors, he reached out to the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He reached out to all people from a position of humility, and his love changed lives. Our love can change lives if we treat one another out of humility with the grace that God has shown us in Jesus. Now, the last thing I want to say is that you heard about the vineyard last week too. Like, Jesus uses a vineyard as a setting for a number of his parables. And one of the parables is that Jesus says, the harvest is large and the workers are few. Why are the workers few? Because some say, yeah, I'll go do that. And then they don't. But the good news is there are others who say, I'm not interested in that. But then somehow they respond to God in a positive way. All of us are called, including little Lincoln. He's just too young to know it yet, but we're all called to be part of the mission of God, to reach out to the world with love and reconciliation so that we can make the world more and more to the place that God intended in the first place. This is part of what it means to be working for the realm of God or the kingdom of God. that already, this is not just something for the future, after we die. This is something that is also unfolding in our presence now. So if we act with humility, love, and compassion, we will make a difference. And people will see that, and then they will say, maybe we should go to the vineyard too. Maybe we should go to the vineyard too. I look forward to seeing you in the vineyard. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing our hymn of the day. And there's a line that particularly I want you to pay attention to. Build us up, Lord, build us up. Help us bear good fruit for you. That's the one line. And then also that we look for God to give us the strength to do what you have called us to do. So, build us up, Lord, number 670. Invite you to be seated for our prayers. Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. Each petition will end with the phrase, "Merciful God," and the congregational response, "Receive our prayer."
Lead us in your truth as we pray for creation. Empower us to look to the interests of others as we make choices that impact the environment. Summon us to be advocates for healthy waterways, habitats, and air. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
Great Comforter, we know that we are surrounded by a legacy of pain. We acknowledge the pain, grief, and sorrow caused by not living respectfully with all people. And we are sorry for the ways that we have dishonored the depths of this pain. Open us, Creator, to the power of interconnectedness. Help us to receive the painful stories and the inspiring dreams of our Indigenous neighbors. With your healing grace, lead us toward your dream of wholeness. Transform us and our community so that we may continually work towards reconciliation and new life. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
Lord, you see more fully into our hearts and all that we can become. We thank you for those who affirm and encourage our growth and development. Bring us to flourish in the warmth of your regard. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
Trusting your goodness, we pray for all caregivers and people who are sick or suffering in any way, especially those in hospital, Lois Keck, Brian Hillis, Mike Solly, and those whom we name in our hearts. Give them strength, encouragement, and consolation in your presence. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
Lord, there is no darkness that can extinguish your eternal light. In this faith, we entrust to you those who have died. May this hope give comfort to those who mourn the loss of loved ones. This week, we pray for the family and friends of Albert Stettner. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
Teach us your paths as we pray for this congregation. Be at work in us and unite us in your love as we labor together for the sake of the gospel. Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray with confidence in the words our Savior gave us. Offering these days. We just have the offering plate at the front, and you're welcome to come and place your offering in there if you've brought one to do that with. With this offering, we return to God some of what God has given to us, and we ask God to bless it to be used for work in the vineyard.
Let us pray. Generous God, we thank you for your abundant gifts. Bless these offerings to build up your people and for your work in the world. Amen.
We'll stand as we sing our sending song, The Lord Now Sends Us Forth. This is number 578. And just a word of warning, because otherwise you might miss it. We repeat each section twice, so it kind of comes fast.
To make up all the earth. Song. Here we go.
The Lord now sends us forth with hands to serve and give, to make of all the earth a better place to live. The Lord now sends us forth with hands to serve and give, to make of all the earth a better place to live. The angels are not sent into our world of pain to do what we were meant to do in Jesus' name. That falls to you and me and all who are made free. Help us, O Lord, we pray, to do your will today. The angels are not sent to do the world of pain, to do what we were meant to do in Jesus' name. That falls to you and me and all who are made free. Help us, O Lord, we pray,
this blessing. May God bless you, the Creator working constantly through change, the Christ who came to share and change our lives, and the Spirit moving in the world and changing it. May God bless you here and now and for all eternity. Amen.
Go in peace, inspired by Christ, to love and serve.